When we think about people that have made a difference in the world and in our community, I find that the people I think of most often are people of humility. And when I say humility, I'm speaking of people who value the opinions and others. I believe others to be important. It's easy to start listing names of the grand figures that practice such humility: Desmond Tutu, Martin Luther King Jr., Mother Teresa. As I think of the people that I might name here in Shelbina, it does seem to be the case that anyone I would name that you're thinking of right now, the humble servants of our community, would be rather annoyed to be named. They don't want it, they just want to keep on doing their thing. I think the importance of humility is something that we see in the gospel today, but we're going to have to take a bit of a journey to get to understanding how this is. What we call the transfiguration, where the glory of Jesus is seen clearly, is really more of a story of the importance of humility. To get there, we have to go back and start reading using the Old Testament, which is the context for everything that happens in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, people go up the mountain often. And when someone goes up the mountain in the Old Testament, something big is going to happen. When Moses goes up Mount Sinai to receive the law, that's when he comes down and he is told his face is shining. And the people can see that something has happened there, that Moses has come close to God. Now, Elijah goes up that same mountain farther down the history of the Jewish people after facing down the 450 prophets of Baal and when Queen Bathsheba is out for him. And so he runs, and he runs this mountain, and he experiences God's presence. It's not in the storm, nor in the earthquake, nor in the fire, but in the sheer silence. As we read of Jesus going up the mountain multiple times, we know, again, with Jesus, when Jesus goes up the mountain, pay attention. Where does Jesus preach his greatest sermon? It's the Sermon on the Mount, right? If you want to hear, that is his take on Moses brought the Ten Commandments down the mountain for the people. Here is Jesus bringing the Sermon on the Mount. It's the interpretation of how we now shall live. Right? What Jesus has done many times before is go up the mountain to get away and seek to be with his Father. This time, he invites the disciples to come with him, or a few of them. When Jesus gets to the top of the mountain, Elijah and Moses show up, and Jesus shines with the same light that had lit up Moses' face long ago, and God's presence is there, as in the cloud, when Elijah went up the mountain. Now, you may have heard the idea that it is the law and the prophets, right? Moses, the law, and Elijah, the prophets, that's where the connection there. I don't think we have to decide how we're reading this. I don't think that's really what's going on. Moses was the first prophet, sort of giving the speaking for God, bringing the Ten Commandments. And if you were looking for the greatest prophet, you'd look at Isaiah. But that's not who shows up. We see Elijah, because Elijah is the one who also has gone up the mountain. Right? And so the idea of going up the mountain and meeting God, that Moses and Elijah have gone up the mountain, and now Jesus is going up the mountain. I think this lines up with what's called recapitulation. The idea that Jesus is recapitulating. Jesus is walking the path of Israel again, and this time he's getting it right, where Israel had failed. And so Jesus goes up the mountain, and as Moses and Elijah had done before, now Jesus does. And so when Jesus is going up the mountain, Jesus has gone up the mountain many times. Why is this the time he brings the disciples? What's changed? Why does Jesus go, you're ready? What have they done? Well, what they have done, the disciples, is they have been doing what Jesus has been telling them to do. They have gone out two by two to go and to serve and to heal and to proclaim the good news. They have fed the 5,000 Jesus tells the disciples, you feed them, right? And the disciples do this. And so then the disciples have had this discussion with Jesus where Jesus says, now, who am I? And some people say, well, you're Moses or Elijah. And Peter finally says, you are the Messiah. And so it feels like this is the point at which the disciples are first ready. Right? They have been serving others and following Jesus and serving others. And Jesus has told them, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders be killed and be raised up on the third day. And if you're going to follow me, deny yourself and take up your cross. Right? They have heard this. And so at this point, they have practiced humility, and they have heard the message of humility, and now they're ready to see the fruit of humility, so to speak. Right? They're ready to realize who Jesus is. They go up the mountain with Jesus, and behold, two men were talking with Jesus, and they were Moses and Elijah, and they see something amazing, and they're seeing for the first time. Like, it's not that Jesus hasn't been glorious the whole time, but now they're seeing it for the first time. And they respond, and they say, "It is good to be here." Now, why do they say that? I mean, again, a decision we have to make in reading Scripture. Are they saying it's good to be here because, man, I needed a break? Man, it's been a rough week. I just needed a vacation. Are they saying it's good to be here because being amongst all those people was getting old? Or are they saying it is good to be here because now we're starting to understand what we've been doing? Right? The service, the humility, the feeding of the 5,000, that now that they're seeing how this all ties together, that in following Jesus, it's not that Jesus is humble and he is glorious. It is that his humility is his glory. Right? Anyone who's Jesus is king and his throne is a cross. That they're starting to see this connection. Now, so Peter then says, and Peter is always talking. Petey, sweet Jesus, stop talking sometimes. But Peter keeps on talking. And he says, "Let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." And again, we have to decide how we're reading this. Whenever we read Scripture, we're trying to read and understand in context. We have to decide how we're going to read it. And it could be, we could read this as the disciples being escapist. Like, man, it's good to get away. Let's pop some tents and just chill here for a week. Let's go camping. Like, let's settle in. Well, I don't think that's really what's happening. I think what's happening is, there is a festival of booths that the Jewish people celebrate, and it's a celebration of the journey that Moses takes them on. And so what do you live in when you're on a journey across the desert? You live in tents. And so popping a tent is not saying, let's hunker down and get away from everybody and take a long weekend. It's, if Moses is here, we must be on a journey. It's a time to just live in a tent for a day, because that's what we do. And then the cloud comes, and the cloud which comes upon Moses, same cloud that comes upon Moses when he is on the mountain, and they hear this voice that says, "This is my son with whom I am well pleased, listen to him." There is no punctuation in Hebrew, and so you got to ask, is God angry? "This is my son with whom I am well pleased. You should be listening to him." Like, this is the tone of voice when your mom uses your middle name. "Andrew Russell Kuhn, are you listening to your mama?" Eek! Right? Is that the tone of voice here? I've never actually said my children's middle names when I'm getting angry at them. I wonder what they would do. Like, I don't know. I'll let you know someday. Or is this more of a sense of like, this is my son. I love him. I'm glad you're doing what he's telling you to. Like, is this more reassuring? The cloud lifts. Moses and Elijah are gone. Jesus is no longer shining, glowing. And they go down the mountain. And I think this is the moment when the disciples begin to realize how deeply humility and glory are connected. And so as we read this, we have to figure out if the disciples are misunderstanding what's going on. They're trying to escape from the pressures of following Jesus by getting up the mountain and staying there, and they get scolded by God. Or are the disciples having a moment when they are understanding in a way that is powerful and new, understanding that Jesus' humility is connected to his glory? I hope it's the latter. That's how I read it. Because I think that's the hope I see for us. That we with the disciples can walk the path of Jesus Christ and see that the fruit of walking a path of such humility is that we will see God more clearly. The disciples could not see Jesus clearly until they had followed him. And having followed him, now they can see something they had not been able to see before. The connection is not something that's intellectual. I can talk about humility all day long. Humility is not something I agree to. It is something I practice. It is something I have to practice again and again and again. And the disciples, they come down off the mountain and they got some practice left to do too, right? Within a few verses, they're arguing about who will be the greatest amongst them, right? They still have some learning to do. But they are not yet to Jerusalem and they have more time to practice this with Jesus. We are coming up on Lent, this season of 40 days between Ash Wednesday and Easter, this time of journeying, of practicing the humility that Jesus lays out before us, the way of Christ. We practice it looking to the promise of the Transfiguration that as we follow the ways of humility, we will see God more clearly. Right, that's what we're seeing here. If you want to know God more, walk in Jesus' humble footsteps. And so as we come to Ash Wednesday and we begin this time of Lent, I'd encourage you to find a practice of humility for these days. Like the stereotypical sort of canard is that you give up Coke or chocolate for Lent. It doesn't matter. Like, that doesn't matter. You give up chocolate, so what? It's not going to change who you are. Figure out a way to be more like Jesus humbly. Listen more than you speak. Pray by name for neighbors. Fast one day a week and give what you would have spent on food to the local food pantry. Visit the nursing home. Buy lunch for a friend. This is not rocket science. This is looking at the people around us and saying, you are valuable, and I want to pay attention to you. That's the way of Jesus. Humility. I encourage you to ponder what is the humble way that you might practice during Lent before we get to Ash Wednesday. To choose to take up something that will help you see Jesus more clearly. And realize that it is not something that we do for Lent and just forget about until Lent comes back around. But Lent is creating an inflection point, a time when we can choose to do something that will hopefully not just change us for a season, but change us for the rest of our lives. This is part of our individual responsibilities as Christians to take this season and to use it to grow. And to grow to be more Christ-like, not because of the pastor done told me. Don't do it because of guilt or pressure. We grow to be more like Christ for the same reason that we want to be a better dad, a better husband, a better parent, a better grandfather. Because in doing so, it is beautiful. We do it out of the love for others. And like the disciples, may we see more of God in our lives in being humble ourselves and seeing God's glory. Amen.